Good morning. Let us begin with prayer. Great and amazing are your deeds, Lord God, the Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Just and true are your ways. Lord, receive our songs and prayers, our worship to your glory, for the sake and in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Good to be together today. We have a delightful blessing in that you are visiting here, some of you, for the very first time. And we are eager to minister to you. You'll find in the pew in front of you a card. And if you'll put your information on that card and place it in the offering plate, then we'll be sure to follow up and contact you. If we can serve you in some way, we're eager to do that. My name is Bill Smith, and I'm the interim associate pastor. Our pastor, Mark Jones, will be the one contacting you, and I know if he hasn't already met you this morning, he's eager to do that. So please speak to him as you depart today, and if you're so inclined, leave your card with us. You'll look at your worship folder and notice that we're using last week's folder because we were snowed out last week. And so instead of reproducing everything, we're using the same worship folder. However, there are some corrections. So listen to the announcements because they may be different than what you read in your worship folder. And on this occasion, what's spoken is correct and what's written may be incorrect. No, I can't. I can't explain that at all. I'm just making it up as I go. One happy announcement, Eric and Casey, our youth minister and his bride, are on their honeymoon. And while we're freezing here, they're in Hawaii. So be happy for them. Not jealous, but happy for them. There will not be Women's Missionary Union tomorrow. If you have sponsored a poinsettia, you may take one home from the steps of the church. The Augusta Baptist Association Cross-Shaped Family Conference, which was scheduled for tonight, has been rescheduled to April. So do not show up tonight. You'll be there by yourself. Comfort Care baby bottles are available in the nursery hallway. You're encouraged to take one or two or more home with you, and you fill them up with spare change, bills, checks. Return them on February 17th. Youth activities are canceled for tonight. Eric is away. And then, reminding those of you on the Young at Heart Council, we are meeting today at noon to plan some wonderful activities for the young at heart. Good to be together today. Let's greet one another as we stand and sing.
Starting with Good, Good Father.
You are, it's who
Ooh.
Thank you so much, Kathy. On Wednesday nights, we share the names of people for whom we're praying. I encourage you to come on Wednesday night and be part of our intercessory prayer time. Let's now enter a moment of meditation and morning prayer. God of tender mercies, hear our prayers, we ask. Bless the bereaved with your comfort. Bring strength and healing to the sick. Encourage us, Lord, with the assurance of pardon for our sins. Strengthen our repentance and make us see the servants of Christ that you want us to be. Bless our church, bless our pastor. Fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Bill. And good morning. I encourage you to open up the Word of God in Genesis, the 37th chapter, verses 1 through 11. And as I begin, let me just make a few announcements on top of all the other announcements we made. Tomorrow is Martin Luther King holiday. It's remembrance of his birthday. We remember the civil rights struggle, the civil rights leader, and the difference that he made in our nation. He is, in my opinion, the best known Baptist preacher in all of history. And so much of his leadership came from the fact that he took his calling and his methods and the integrity of how he did things through the gospel of Jesus Christ, not through political philosophy, not through force of arms, but by the grace of God. And we are a better people today because of that. Also, today is National Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. And in my preaching plan and other things that I plan on doing that, I plan on speaking on that today. But folks, we got snowed out last Sunday, and so we're going to move that and speak on that next Sunday. It works real well with the series that I'm doing. And also, we've got some things to share with you from Comfort Care. Comfort Care is a ministry that a number of people in our church are involved in. Jen Wade works there, and I encourage you to take... I just expect you to take one or two bottles home with you and fill those things up. It's a wonderful ministry working towards the ministering to women in our area, as other ministries as well. And also the third thing is, a number of people are normally here in the 9 o'clock will be here in the 11 o'clock, or at least I sure hope they will be, is because we're having deacon ordination. We are ordaining two new deacons today, and I encourage you, if you can, come to the 11 o'clock as well. Becky Park and also Karen Dodson will be ordained for deacon ministry, as well as we welcome our other new deacons into rotation for the three-year rotation. Deacons are a blessing to this church. They are a blessing to this pastor, and they are a blessing to the kingdom work that God chooses to do here in and through Memorial Baptist. Well, as I mentioned, we're beginning a series, and it was supposed to end in February, and probably now end sometime in March. But it's about integrity, and it's focusing on the character of Joseph. And you might not think this, but of all the people in the book of Genesis, you may think that Abraham gets the most attention, or Noah. There's certainly more movies made about Noah than Joseph, but Joseph actually gets more print in the book of Genesis than any other character. And when we're looking at this, one thing that speaks to me is his character. He moves from a person that's self-centered and arrogant, goes through a miserable process of refining, and comes out an incredible man of integrity. And so there is a series that I'm going to share with you tonight, the next few weeks, that we're going to focus on different areas of integrity. The greater story is about the part that he plays in what God is choosing to do in keeping his promise with Abraham, moving through the generation to make a great people out of what starts with one son, the next generation, two sons, but the older son rejects his inheritance, so we're still back to one son, but then the next one will marry, and actually he marries two women at the same time, by the way, and also has children through the two handmaids, and so they jump forward real quick with 12 sons and several daughters as well. And so that's the overarching story. But we're going to be talking about integrity. And the message of integrity starts with the dreamer, Joseph. Let me share with you from the Word of God, verses 1 through 11. Jacob lived in the land where his father had stayed, the land of Canaan. These are the family records of Jacob. At 17 years of age, Joseph tended sheep with his brothers. The young man was working with the sons of Bilhah and Zilpah, his father's wives. Those were the handmaids. They were considered lesser sons. And he brought a bad report about them to his father. Now Israel loved Joseph more than his other sons because Joseph was a son born to him in his old age, and he made a robe of many colors for him. When his brothers saw that their father loved him more than all his brothers, they hated him and could not bring themselves to speak peaceably to him. Then Joseph had a dream, and he told his brothers that and they hated him even more. He said to them, "Listen to this dream I had. There were binding sheaves of grain in the field. Suddenly my sheaf stood up, and your sheaves gathered around it and bowed down to my sheaf. Are you really going to reign over us?" his brothers asked him. "Are you really going to rule us?" So they hated him even more because of his dreams and what he had said. Then he had another dream and told it to his brothers. "Look," he said, "I had another dream. And this time the sun, the moon, and 11 stars were bowing down to me." He told his father and brothers this, but his father rebuked him. "What kind of dream is this that you've had?" he said. "Are your mother and brothers and I going to bow down to the ground before you?" His brothers were jealous of him, but his father kept the matter in mind. Has God given you a dream? I don't mean a fantasy. I don't mean something that went through your subconscious the night before that you could barely remember. I'm talking about a vision. Something that you feel stirred in your heart is from God. And it may be a vision that he's placed upon your life about your business, about what you do for a vocation, about what you do with your spare time, what type of husband or wife that you are, what type of child that you are. Perhaps it's a ministry. Perhaps it's all rolled in together. How do you know it's from God? How do you know it's not some well-intentioned fantasy? Well, hopefully we're going to give you some clarity on that this morning. I've got several principles to share with you, and I'll share them with you briefly. First of all, I want you to know the first principle is called but not ready. Just because you were called by God does not necessarily mean at this point that you are ready to act on that calling. God is not so much interested in the output as much as he's interested on developing your character. See, when we receive the Holy Spirit, that's the beginning of the transformation that God is wanting to do and continues to do throughout our entire life, chiseling us away towards the image of Jesus. And so, while there is maybe concern about the outcome, he's more concerned about what's going on inside you. He'll use you according to his will and purposes, and according to his timing, he will develop you. But just because you sense that calling, it might just mean it's the beginning of a long journey that's ahead of you. I've shared with you several times that I didn't become a Christian until I was 20 years old. And it was about 4 months after that I sensed God's calling in my life. And folks, that was 1980. And since then, how long ago was that? Well, 1980, 38 years ago, starting on 39 years ago, God has continued to shape and reshape, still moving towards that vision, still moving towards that calling, brought me to times of crisis, then guided me over times of crisis that further refined that calling that is placed in my life. It's been according to how God chooses and wants to do these things. But I will also tell you, and I've not shared this with you before, that when I was 16, folks, 4 years before I became a Christian, I had an encounter with the Holy Spirit where I felt God saying to me, "I've got something special for your life. I felt a calling. Didn't know what it was. Was I ready? Folks, I wasn't even a believer. I wasn't even a Christ follower at that time. But God spoke to me and continues to refine my life towards the calling that He is shaping me continually in. When God places a calling on your life, He doesn't give it all to you. He doesn't give you all the dates and the timing exactly how it's going to be done. And I think there's two reasons for that. First of all, you might be reactive. If God gave it all to you, shared it all with you, you, probably the most of us, would run away from it. But the second reason is that we might be proactive, that we might take that calling and start making our own plans independent of God. You see, when God places a calling upon you, it's far greater than you can do in your own strength. When you try to take that calling upon yourself and try to do it according to your timing, according to your strength, it's a guarantee that you will face misery and failure. God gives us the vision and the understanding a step at a time according to His will and purposes as He's shaping us and moving us in that calling. Another thing, no place for arrogance. Now, Joseph is favored. You've probably heard about that story so many times. He has a coat. Very often it's described as a coat of many colors. And what the scriptures really say, a more correct translation of the Hebrew, is that it's an ornate robe, a tunic that goes all the way down to your hands and all the way down to your feet. And it's a way of taking on and wearing a nice suit and saying to the rest of the world that's out there working, look at me. I'm wearing something special. In fact, I'm wearing something that's so special that I really can't work with the rest of you guys. I'm kind of in a supervisory or just above you type of situation. And he would strut around in those clothes while his other 10 brothers, Benjamin was probably a preschooler at that time, but his other 10 brothers were wearing work clothes, coarser clothes, cheaper clothes, things that the sleeves went up to here and they were short-waisted. Why? Because you needed to get down into your work when you were working with sheep and working in the field. And so it was just a natural contrast. And his father would send him out this. And I see some 17-year-olds out there, but this arrogant 17-year-old would come out there to these full-grown men and then go back to dad and give bad reports. Of course they didn't like him. And it was a dysfunctional family. Man, the guy had sons by four different mothers. They didn't even like each other. They were men of low character. And because, even with all that, Joseph is arrogant. If you have a calling, if God has given you a dream and a vision, you need to be humble, not exalted because of that. Because the vision, the calling comes from God. The dependency that you're going to need to see that through comes from God. If you think that you could do it in your own strength, your own ability, as Joseph was doing at the time, and he's got some changes coming, but at the time, it's going to go very, very bad. Folks, if God has placed a calling on your life, the glory has to go to God. There is no place for arrogance. Here's another truth, is that dreamers get targeted. Dreamers, people that have vision, are naturally agents of change. We do not call people that maintain the status quo as dreamers or visionary people. And some people, they struggle with change. To some degree, we all struggle with change, but we can't go forward without it. If God has placed a vision, a calling upon your life, you're going to be by necessity an agent of change. And whether or not you are walking with God or walking in your own strength, because you are an agent of change, you're going to be a target for some people. And folks, that's not any fun. But even within that, it draws you to be dependent upon your relationship with God. It's not the most fun part of having a dream or having a calling, but it is part of the territory. And also, what it means to be divinely reinforced. Now, it's interesting, and the scripture is very intentional, that you understand that there are two visions given to Joseph. Okay, the first vision, the first dream that he had was the sheaves. These were agricultural people. That was their context. The sheaves, the bundles of whatever it is that they were collecting, all 12 of them were out there collecting those sheaves, and all of a sudden, the sheaves bowed to his sheaf. And then to make it worse, that made him very angry. To make it worse, he talked about another thing. He talked about the sun that represents his father. There was the moon that represents his mother. And then the 11 stars, his brothers, and they all bowed down to him. Well, in ancient cultures, if you had a dream that were similar in interpretation, it was a way of saying that God had reinforced that dream. I mean, if you had a dream and a vision that you felt like came from God, that was to be taken seriously, but I don't know, maybe it was just a bad fantasy, or maybe you ate something wrong the night before and you just kind of had some crazy stuff going on in your head. Maybe you're misinterpreting things, but when there's a second one that comes along and it reinforces the first one, that's called divine reinforcement. You see that later happening with Pharaoh when Joseph interprets Pharaoh's dreams. You see that happen later with the prophet Samuel. And you also see that with other prophets as well, like Daniel. It was a way of saying God has not only instituted this, God is also saying, I am putting my stamp of approval on this. Now, how do you know if your dreams, your calling, the vision that God has placed upon your life is divinely reinforced? Well, here's some things that we know about God. God's character is consistent. It was consistent at creation. It was consistent before creation. It's consistent today. It will be consistent through all eternity. We see his character, we have much of his character, the parameters of his character seen in Scripture. If you think that God has given you a vision or calling and it is contradictory Scripture, it is not divinely reinforced. But also, keep in mind that this faith, this Christianity, is about relationship with God. That is why God invests his Holy Spirit into your life. That is why it is important that you walk closely with God. That's the reason why it's important that you be able to tell when the Holy Spirit is speaking to your life. That is how you know that you are being divinely reinforced. It comes so much by walking closely with God. And remember through all of this that God may not always be seen or mentioned, but he is always present and at work. If you look at the passage that I just read to you, it says nothing about God. Now, Jacob, also known as Israel, had intense experiences with God. His sons, I'm sure that they worship God. I'm sure that they recognize God. But we know by their character and their actions, both by what we see here, what we know what's coming, and also what we've seen previously, that their lifestyles did not reflect a godly nature. He was probably somebody that they tipped their hat towards, but he made very little difference in their day-to-day life. And yet, we know the greater story. We know that God's hand is working in and through this process. We know that God is working through this and through the terrible tragedies that are about to happen in Joseph's life. We see an abrupt change in his character. He becomes this man of intense integrity. And I'll tell you something else. We even see that these dirty, low-down rascals, which are his brothers, we see a change in character in them as well later. We see God working through history to where he takes 12 brothers and their families, and 400 years later comes out of Egypt with over 1 million people. They leave that morning as slaves. They go out probably one of the wealthiest, if not the wealthiest nation on earth as God delivers them through that. God is always at work. If God has placed a calling upon your life, if God has given you a vision in your life, even if you walk closely with him, there will be times where it seems like he is distant. There will be times that you will feel like you are very much in the desert. There will be times when you even perhaps question that calling. God is always there. God is always at work. Let me pray for you. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you so much for speaking to us through the Word of God, speaking to us about the process of integrity through our dreams and callings. Father, however it is that you are speaking to us today, I pray that we will not leave this place unchanged. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. This morning, we go into a time of invitation. If God has placed a calling upon your life, perhaps you need to come to the altar and pray. Perhaps you've accepted Christ, you want to make that public. Perhaps he said to you, this is your church home, and you'd like to make that public. Whatever God has placed upon your life, we are invited to come forward. Our song is The Potter's Hand. Please stand.
Take me.
bless you. Have a seat for just for a moment. We are very excited to welcome into our fellowship the Austins. Come on up here. This is Alana, okay, Heather, and Craig. They've been visiting our church for close to a year now or so, and probably a lot of you thought they were already members of our church. We're so excited to have them in our church. I've, of course, talked with them many times, and it was in their home yesterday. They come on a statement of faith from a like-minded Christian fellowship. They've all know what it means to be saved by grace through faith. They've been baptized by water immersion, and they would like to be a part of the fellowship of Memorial Baptist Church. Do I have a motion they be accepted? Boy, there's a bunch of them out there. All in favor, say amen.
Amen.
And we welcome you. All right. So we're excited to have them here, and I encourage you to come forward after the service and shake their hand and welcome them into the fellowship of Memorial Baptist Church. But before we do that, we have a song.
Will you stand and sing God's Ways My Way?
God bless you for coming to Memorial Baptist Church this morning for worship. Bill, will you close us in prayer? So good. God bless you.
Let us pray. We thank you, Lord, for the blessing it is to recognize and welcome into this fellowship in a more formal way the Austin family, and we do pray your blessings upon them especially. And Lord, we know that you are faithful. And we ask you to watch over us and keep us safe in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ today and always. Amen.